Hey, how's it going? Bill Lethman here for Money Evolution. In this video, I'm going to be talking about why your retirement plan assumptions may be dead wrong. So if you're somebody that's put together a plan for your retirement, maybe you've worked with a financial advisor, or maybe you're using one of the many online retirement planning tools, and you've been given a probability of a successful retirement using something called Monte Carlo, what I'm going to be talking about in this video are some thoughts and some ideas on why that Monte Carlo may be giving you potentially a false positive impression of what your retirement could look like. In other words, skewing the results to be looking a little bit more favorable than what it may actually be in reality here. So if you are in that situation, I think this video is going to be maybe one of the most important videos that you watch when it comes to planning for your retirement. In fact, in preparation for this video, I started coming across a little bit of some research on this, and that's what got me thinking about maybe taking a deeper dive into Monte Carlo. But when I did a Google search, or even a search on YouTube, I really couldn't find a lot of people talking about this. I think a lot of people are relying on this Monte Carlo assumption. So in this video, like I said, I'm going to break it all down and give you some of the truths, I think, on how Monte Carlo works and how it could potentially mislead some people into thinking their retirement is in better shape than it may actually be, or maybe not understanding fully what some of the risks are when it comes to that withdrawal strategy in retirement. So anyway, if you're watching this video and you're resonating with some of the things we're talking about here, you'd like to learn a little bit more about what we do at Money Evolution, we've got some links down in the description below. You can head over to moneyevolution.com. We've got some great free resources there. Our retirement time machine program for people planning and preparing for retirement. It's more of a DIY program. And then, of course, we have our Money Evolution plan, which is our high-level, comprehensive one-on-one financial planning that we do with clients. Okay, so now when we talk about planning for retirement, there's obviously a lot of variables that we just don't know the answers to. We don't know what the rate of return is going to be, and in particular, what the sequence of those returns are going to be. We also don't know what the rate of inflation is going to be. Sometimes it could be really high, like it is tending to be right now. Other times throughout history, the inflation rate has been very low. We also really don't know what our spending is going to be and what some of those expenses are. We can put together budgets and we can plan pretty well for that, but still, things like our expenses are even going to be variable a little bit over time. So when we're doing this financial planning, and especially planning for retirement, we want to try to come up with a way or a system to more or less kind of account for some of the randomness. When we're doing financial planning, and in particular, when we're doing cash flow retirement planning, most financial planning software is going to just use a straight line level of growth. So for example, if we said we think 5% is going to be our long-term average growth rate for our portfolio, the plan and the planning software is going to really just run a straight line level of that growth. It's going to be 5% every single year. Now, we know that that's not going to be the case. We know there's going to be a lot of variability with the rates of return. Some years it might be 5, other years it might be minus 5, minus 15, minus 20. Other years it might be up 15 or 20% per year. But this will at least give us a little bit of a target to see if we're on track. And really, like we're going to talk about here in a little bit, the most important part of that cash flow plan is really understanding what the gaps are and how much you may need to withdraw from the portfolio each year. That's not really going to be the focus of what we're going to talk about here in this video today. But generally, we want to keep that withdrawal rate to 4% or less because of some of these variabilities of returns. And that's what we're going to really talk about there. The financial planning community has come up with a couple of different ways to plan for some of the variability of this. We can run stress tests on the portfolio, but probably one of the most common ways that we can do this is through something called Monte Carlo simulation. And Monte Carlo, on the surface, sounds like a really great strategy for basically being able to account or accommodate for some of the variability of returns that we might expect to see over our retirement that could last for hopefully 20 or 30 years or longer. And what Monte Carlo does is it basically randomizes returns and basically runs somewhere north of 1,000 different simulations, basically replicating rates of return that maybe have occurred in the past and showing, you know, what that might look like. If one year you're down 15%, the next year you're up 15%, you get a 25%, but then you get a 30 or 40% correction in there. And it sounds, like I said, on the surface, like it makes a lot of sense to try to create some plans for some of that variability. And so it's going to run essentially 1,000 or more of these simulations and look at what if there's some bad years early? What if there are some bad years late or in the middle, and run 1,000 different outcomes? And it's going to come back with a probability score. It's going to range basically from zero, hopefully you're not at zero, all the way up to 100% probability, according to the Monte Carlo, of having success. I'm going to look at this because 77% is a hypothetical example that we're going to take a look at, and we're going to show how making a couple of changes to the rates of return affects that potential outcome and why I think there's a big flaw with how that is done. So to understand this, we really need to understand something called the bell-shaped curve, or the distribution of numbers, or the distribution of returns over time. And so basically, going back to my college statistics class that I so desperately tried to forget some of the stuff, but it keeps coming back, and it is a very important part of a lot of things we do. If we said, for example, that 5% average growth rate that we're going to assume, there's going to be a distribution of returns depending on something called the standard deviation and the variability of those returns. So if we said, for example, that this investment, this portfolio, if you will, has a standard deviation of 10, what that would tell us is that we can divide this up into a couple of different standard deviations. So the first standard deviation is basically going to say that we have a 34% chance that we're going to be one standard deviation less. So that means that we're going to be between essentially minus 15%, I'm sorry, minus 5% and plus 15%. Okay, and that's one standard deviation. So basically, if we're distributing this on a random basis here, 68% of the outcomes in the situation are going to fall between minus 5 and plus 15. I'm going to make that look a little nicer here. So minus 5. We go out one more standard deviation, and that's where we get to our 95% confidence level. And that's going to go one more standard deviation. So that would mean that we would be at plus 25 or minus 15. And so obviously 95% is a pretty good odds that we're going to be somewhere within that. But there is still going to be 5% of the time that we could be another standard deviation outside of that and see a return in this situation that would be greater than 25% or something that would be less than 15%. So that's just a little basic knowledge on that. Now, if we said, okay, we don't like this idea that we're at 77%, and this is certainly not the recommendation that I would have here, but I want to do this to kind of prove a point here on the Monte Carlo. We said 5% average is just not good enough. So of course, if we could get a better rate of return, that would improve our odds, okay? So if we went from 5%, and let's say we developed a portfolio that was gonna be an average of 9%, what does that look like? Well, we're gonna have a little bit different bell-shaped curve. It's going to be a lot wider here because we're going to have a lot higher standard deviation. Just for some simple math here, we're going to say we have a 20% standard deviation. So that means that if we go into our 68% probability, we can see a return that could be as high as 29% or minus 11%. And to go out even further, go out one more standard deviation, that means that with a 95% confidence, we're going to see somewhere between minus 31 and plus 49. So the first problem with Monte Carlo and how this works is that you can see in both situations, most of our returns are going to be right there in the middle. It's going to say that most of the time, our returns are going to be real close to that 9% or to the 5%. But what I don't like about this is that we just doubled the risk of the portfolio. We went from a 10% standard deviation to a 20% standard deviation. We did improve the return. We didn't quite double it. I guess we could play around with that. Maybe we could use 10% instead of 9% or whatever. But I did that because the models inside of our eMoney financial planning software use a growth model as 8.96% as the growth rate there. But basically, you know, the thing I don't like about this is that by increasing the return, and as we're going to look in the software, it actually increased our probability. I think it's 94%, I think, and we'll look in the software here in a second, but it increased our return. Now, a couple things about this. So minus 31, That's saying that 95% of the time, we're not going to have a return less than minus 31. Well, we can go back over just the recent history, and we can look at the period of time in the early 2000s when the tech bubble crashed and when the great financial crisis and the whole financial collapse happened in 2008 with the housing and everything. We saw 50% corrections in both of those situations. And this right here is maybe not going to capture that in terms of the Monte Carlo here. So so I don't really like the way this this goes here. So I'm going to throw our financial planning software up on the screen and show you what that looks like here. And there we are. So this is our what we call our base facts, and this is just a hypothetical client, Steve and Sandy Bishop. We've used them in other videos here on the channel. But again, with a 5% growth rate for the portfolio, they're at 77%. And then if I come in here and I created an alternate scenario with a higher rate of return, we went up to that growth model at 8.96. I was off by one there, so I said 94. It's actually 93% probability. But we went to basically a green light versus a yellow caution light for the client's retirement. I would not feel confident in my retirement or recommending the retirement for a client that was in that 77 percentile, just not strong enough. But 93%, this is giving somebody a pretty high level of confidence. What I really don't like about this is the fact that, again, we took on a substantial amount more risk. There's a lot more chance for something to go wrong. And yet Monte Carlo is telling us that, you know, this is the successful plan, that this is going to be a 93% probability there. So that's flaw number one, is how those returns are distributed. I don't think really gives us a good representation of what the actual markets are like. The second thing that I don't really like about the Monte Carlo is it doesn't pick up on cyclical trends in the financial market. So you probably know or at least heard of the boom and bust cycle. So financial markets are not really random. The economy is not really random. In other words, we don't have a really great economy one year and a really bad economy next year, and then it's really good again. It tends to go in cycles, you know, and it, you know, as let's say an economy is coming out of a recession, you know, people start getting a little bit more confidence. They start spending a little bit more money. Businesses have a little bit more money, so they start hiring more people. That gets more people involved in the economy. They feel more confident. They spend more money, and it kind of cycles through that, you know, goes through time as it's coming out of, let's say, a recovery phase. And then the same thing happens at the top end of it too. You know, there's some things that start to slow down a little bit. Things get a little bit exhausted out on the top, and then maybe some businesses start to see some slowdown in sales, and they lay off some people, and then they spend less money, obviously, because they are out of a job. And so it tends to snowball in each way here. This is something from Guggenheim, one of the investment companies here, and they put together this really nice chart. What I like about it is that it actually goes back all the way to the beginning of the Dow Jones Industrial Average, all the way back to 1897, and looks at these secular bull and bear markets. And you can see, you know, there's purple, which represents kind of the sideways or the bear markets, and the gray, which represent the bull markets. And first thing I always notice, you know, and point out on this chart is that it appears that the purple areas or the bear markets really represent a lot more time on the calendar than some of the bull markets. But our retirement is really going to be a lot of it, somewhat, you know, I hate to say the word luck, but it is going to be a luck thing if we are in, if we're retiring at the beginning of a bull market, if we're retiring at the beginning of a bear market or a sideways market, or if we're in the middle of one or the other, and how long that lasts. And we don't know exactly how long any of these are going to last. I mean, some of these periods last as short as 5 years. If we're talking about a bull market, if we're talking about a bear market, The most significant was 25 years during the Great Depression. So if you had any kind of a retirement during that period of time, that's going to be a very difficult obstacle to overcome when we're talking about taking out retirement withdrawals and everything. That variability is not really going to be picked up on the Monte Carlo, because Monte Carlo, again, is going to randomize every single year, and it's not going to pick up on the idea that you could have a number of years left in whatever cycle you happen to be. So it's not going to take into account, for example, 2000, where the S&P lost about 9% and lost another 11% in 2001, and then lost about 22% in 2002. So three back-to-back-to-back years. Or 2008 financial crisis, which saw a 57% drop from the top to the bottom on the S&P 500, basically took a little bit over, I think, about 18 months or so from that whole thing. So it may pick up on like a minus 8 or whatever that might have been for the first part of that downturn, and it may be like a minus 30-35% for the second part of it. And it may not be capturing all of those negatives in terms of the rate of return and everything. So if you're using Monte Carlo for your retirement planning, if you've ever done one of these plans, whether it was online or with a financial advisor, and it came back with a probability, just be careful. Just be careful that this should not be the only thing that you base your retirement on. It's one of many factors to look at. And really, I think what is the most important factor, because we just don't know the future, but it's to really understand your cash flow. And that's one of the things that we do with the financial plans, even the retirement time machine that we do with clients, that's more of the DIY program there. But really understanding, like we're looking at this cash flow here, these numbers in red represent the amount of withdrawals coming out of the portfolio each year, and then planning for that accordingly and building out silos of different buckets, and not, of course, having all of your money just invested in one basket that may be a growth basket or may even be a diversified basket, but you're pulling from the same basket every year is not the best approach to that. You want to have, we typically recommend 2 years of cash flow needs set aside, liquid, something safe like a money market, something that's going to be maybe FDIC insured, something along those lines. A middle basket that may cover another 3 to 5 years of cash flow needs, something like a CD ladder, again, something still pretty conservative, still something at the shorter end, and then you can have some growth assets in there. But I think especially as we get late into a cycle here, like we are now with the current run-up, we've had a couple hiccups in there along the way with the COVID crash, and 2022 was a down year. But really, as I'm making this video here today, the major market indexes here, May of 2024, are again hitting new highs. So we don't know if this is going to continue on for a few more years. Nobody has any kind of a crystal ball for that, or if we are in those late stages and we could be going into the next secular downtrend in the market. But trying to have a plan for accommodating that. And you probably have heard about it, probably heard me talk about it. Something called the 4% rule is going to be very important to keep that in mind. I think 4% is really the upper end of the bar for what is a sustainable withdrawal rate from a retirement portfolio over time. A lot of new research from Morningstar and from Merrill Lynch, other companies that have done this, really suggest it might be in the mid threes. Some of them even say it should be below 3% per year to accommodate for this. But one of the things that you want to look at, and we see here on this detailed withdrawals page here from our financial plan, and this is our hypothetical client, early part of retirement, their withdrawal rate is actually a little bit higher. It's actually over 4%, 4.68, 4.77, even approaching 6%, almost 7% there. That, in our opinion, and the research really supports it, is just too high of a withdrawal rate. Anyway, hope that makes sense. Hope you understand a little bit more about the Monte Carlo and how that works, the distribution of returns, and why I think could be, quite honestly, misleading a lot of people into having a false positive for what they think their retirement outcomes are looking like based on some of this this modeling. So anyway, hope you enjoyed today's video. Don't forget to like and subscribe the channel here. Follow along with everything we're doing. Check out some of those resources and the website that we have down in the description below. And I will see you back in one of our next videos. Thanks.